I wake up in an old trailer. I'm laying on a camping mattress with a red scarf over me like a blanket. It smells like Barrow, but he's nowhere to be seen. The old bed mattress under the camping one is entirely covered by loose springs and rust stains. There's a large backpack on the table, next to a beer can, and a full canteen by my side that I empty in a matter of seconds. I hear the sound of fire coming from outside. There's a smell of fish cooking too. But before I can get up, my stomach reminds me I haven't eaten for some time. Someone's getting up outside, and as the trailer door opens, the big hyena greets me with a warm smile. The cold air from outside bursts in, ushering me to put on the scarf he left me. Are you feeling any better? I got some food for us and some water so you could clean your paws before eating. Rub some wet sand from the bottom so you can get rid of the stains. It might help a little. I get grease stains on my fur all the time when I'm out, and sand helps a lot, so, you hungry? He scratches his neck and wags his tail a little as his warm smile turns into a nervous one. I can't shake the feeling that there's something wrong. Why is he being so kind to me? He doesn't know me. Why are you being so kind to me? You don't even know who I am or from whom this came. I look at the blood all over my paws, and some memories come back. I feel my eyes getting wet again as a knot forms in my throat. What if I did something horrible to someone? He looks at me with his ears down and a defeated smile on his face. I know you don't want to talk about that, and I won't ask. I thought you could tell me when you were ready. And after earlier, well, I don't see why I shouldn't give you some trust. His eyes catch mine as he stops talking. He's embarrassed. Well, I just cried myself to sleep in his arms. Fuck, I should be the one embarrassed, but I'm so emotionally exhausted right now that I can't even think straight. I grasp my head, holding back tears, and force my mouth shut. Look, I know it's a risky move to bring you to the settlement, but I'll take it. But I have to ask you, do you trust me? He's smiling again, nervously. Does he expect me to say I don't trust him? I compose myself again while he waits patiently for an answer. He looks like a puppy that did something wrong and was caught in the act. That nervous question made me worry for a moment, but he's my only chance of getting out of this hell, so of course, I trust him. I have to. I chuckle a little and nod to Barrow as we leave the trailer, and he closes the door behind us. Yes, I trust you. I owe you my life. Literally. Outside, I notice some suspicious-looking stuff cooking over a fire pit. I feel my mouth watering. Next to the trailer, I find a water bowl with some sand on the bottom. I crouch and sink my paws into the water, rubbing sand between my fingers. Why the question? Oh, nothing. It's just, I mean, you owe me nothing, really. But you'll need to trust me, because... He is nervous. Why is he so nervous? Well, I may have to smuggle you unnoticed into the settlement, and that means skulking around some patrolling men. You see, I'm not on good terms with the gate security. I kind of got my scavenging rights revoked for some time and shouldn't even be here right now. So, if I stood in front of the gate, especially with someone unknown beside me, they would use it to get me kicked out or locked up, no questions asked. Oh great, I was saved by a criminal! No, it's nothing like that. It was just a smallish mistake I made that got me into trouble in another that made me look really bad. When my paws are mostly clean, I dry them in my jeans. Not a good choice to cross the desert. I feel my thighs burning. Looking at my paws, there's just a little rose tint left, but that won't go away easily, and even if it were all gone, it wouldn't matter. I get up feeling dizzy, and I almost fall, but I manage to hold onto the door handle and sit against the trailer. You should eat. Let me help you. Barrow motions to grab me, but I use his paw to lift myself up instead. The dizziness doesn't get to me this time. I'm okay, but I sure would like something to eat. As if on cue, my stomach growls like a savage beast again. Barrow smiles and lets me go on my own. As I watch my surroundings, I see that astounding view in front of me. Wow. It gets better in the daylight. How can you say that? Look at all those stars reflecting on the lake, like an unending sea of stars. He lightly grabs my chin and motions for my head to look at the night sky. Or you can just look up and have a better view. But yeah, day or night, it's amazing, and I never get tired of it. I've never seen the sky like that. Back in the colony, we could just see a handful of stars through a cloudy sheet of reinforced glass. And yet, I loved every single moment. Now come, you should eat something before your stomach summons some kind of demon. It's been making all sorts of noises since I brought you here. He messes up my hair and sits by the fire. I take his lead and do the same, already reaching for a fish-looking thing on a stick. Is it even edible? Well, at the very least, it smells delicious. So, what did you do that got you into so much trouble? He scratches his neck nervously while looking at the fire. Okay, I suppose it's just something stupid, so... There's this girl from the gate patrol. You see, I really thought I liked her, but in the end, I didn't. Well, that's... normal? Did she got angry because of that? But I didn't tell her that. Instead, I got so drunk at a party in her house that I slept with her best friend in her bed. Oh. Yeah, well, she caught us, threw us out naked, and proceeded to make my life hell. He grabs one of the fish-like things for him, and I can see his tail wag when he sees me really enjoying mine. Whatever it is, it's very good, and I want more. Still, that doesn't explain why you got your scavenging license revoked. What did you do? Oh, I brought a bomb to the settlement. A bomb? So you are a criminal! We chuckle as he rolls his eyes and I reach for another fish thing. I'm starving. So, what were you going to do with that bomb? Oh, I didn't know it was a bomb, and that's why they revoked my license. And now, until I get a more responsible partner to work with me, they won't let me leave. But I need credits, so I found a way out, and I'm selling stuff I find with a borrowed trading license. He shows me a small credential, the name Tristan printed on it. I don't know why, but that name is somehow nostalgic. All those license thingies in a free city sound overly complicated. When we planned to leave, we thought that life would be simpler out of hell. He points the stick that holds the half-eaten, almost fish creature to my face and pokes my nose gently as he starts to speak. You just jumped from first-class hell to the standard hell experience, mister. I butt a small part of his food as he pokes my nose with it. Hey, you have yours, you little rascal. That gets a little smile from both of us, but I can't help but think, how will I manage to survive on my own? Huh, if you use the same credits, I must have a good amount of credits to go without working for a week or two. I can't see how I could be useful here, so I might need some time to figure that out. Actually, I don't even know if I want to be there without Adrian. It feels wrong. There isn't a lot to do in Lauren. That's the name of the settlement, by the way. But I think you might be familiar with the escape. Lauren, that's Adrian's mother. She was the one who led the rebellion against his father all those years ago. Adrian said she would be waiting for us, but how am I going to tell her? I feel my chest tighten, but I try to focus on Baro, which should keep me calm for now. Anyway, it might not be that hard to find something to do, but you'll probably need to learn a thing or two. To be honest with you, the northern city is much more advanced than us. You would feel at home there, but they're not that keen on strangers living amongst them. But they still let us into the city. We just can't live there. So if you ever need entertainment or some nostalgia, you can visit there. That will cost you a lot, though. So there are people who have survived outside of our colony. Perhaps they had their own colony. That is a possibility. I mean, he already told me there were people outside. I don't know why I expected villagers with pitchforks instead of an actual city. I lay on my back and looked at the stars. I'm having a migraine. It was too much for a single day. I don't even know how I fit into all of this. You should be here with me, Adrian. I sit back again, looking through the fire, remembering our time together. Tears roll over my face, and I can feel my chest tightening once more, but before I can start crying, a heavy paw ruffles my hair again. I know it's hard right now. I lost people I loved when I escaped too. It gets easier, I promise. He holds my face and wipes the tears, locking his big green eyes into mine with that soft and welcoming smile on his face. I'll make sure you have the time you need to process everything that happened before they ask anything of you. For now, we should go to sleep. Use the bed. It's too cold. He lets go of me, and I nod, getting to my feet and going inside, as I notice only one bed. If I use the bed, where will you sleep? He puts on a comforting smile as he picks up the water bowl and throws the water over the fire. I'll be okay on the floor. It wouldn't be the first time. Don't worry. Nonsense, please. There's enough space for both of us. Well, only if it's not something, you know, too strange for you. I just don't want you to get a cold because of me. No. I mean, yes. I just meant that I don't find it weird or anything like that. I have an inquisitive look on my face. Did I make him sad with all that's happening to me? He looks fine, a little nervous and embarrassed, but he was all smiles until now. I can tell you more another time. We really should sleep. I give him some room on the mattress and pat it twice. Would he mind if I hugged him? No, I shouldn't. That might be too much for me right now. As I'm thinking this, he approaches cautiously, lying beside me, tail tucked and paw used as a pillow. I do the same and close my eyes, feeling his back against mine. Sleep well, Barrow. You too, Bram. Good night. It feels like hours are passing, but I can't sleep. Thoughts are running wild in my mind, and I can't get a hold of myself. I'm trembling and clenching my jaw and paw so I can hold back the tears. Are you okay? You're trembling. He has a tired voice. Did I wake him up? I hope not. Yes, just a little cold. A lie. I just don't want to bother him even more. Sorry, I only bring covers in the winter. It's okay, you don't need to apologize for that. Talking to him calms me down, and I no longer feel like a trembling pincher, but it shouldn't keep us awake. Yet, I don't think I'm going to fall asleep with all these thoughts inside my head. Maybe I could ask him for a hug? Is that too invasive, or rather too soon? I just met him. I don't even know if I can really trust him. I mean, he could have left me to die or even killed me, but instead he took me somewhere safe, gave me food, and offered me a bed. And what about him? Why would he trust a guy with bloodstained clothes and fur to be by his side right now? I don't think he even wanted to be here. He said he was okay sleeping on the floor, but I insisted and... I sigh and hold my face. I'm overthinking again. But... I need someone to hold right now, or that's not right. Okay, so I'm not really sure about, you know, hugging someone you just met, but we are in a post-apocalyptic world, and I am, you know, feeling very down right now. Bram is feeling very down right now, and he wants a hug, so I think let's choose I need someone to hold right now, and if Barrow doesn't like it, then we just go back. Barrow, can I hug you? I feel his neck sinking in between his shoulders, but his tail is wagging like a puppy's. Okay, actually. He tumbles on his back and takes off his jacket, folding it and using it as a pillow. That is taking up almost the entire space on the bed and gluing me to the back of the trailer. He finally pats his chest, his tail lashing over the mattress and making thudding noises. As I lay my head on his chest, I could hear his heart beating fast. I can't help but let out a chuckle. Huh, are you sure you're okay with that? Your heart is beating really fast right now. I'm okay. It's just, it reminds me of someone from the past. Someone that used to make me happy. His fur is soft and a bit musky, but I'm not one to judge. I need a bath. I feel his arm going under me and reaching for my back, pulling me closer and holding me softly. Hey kid, sleep well. His words are soft and have a sad tone to them. I think about asking, but it's better to leave it alone. You too. Is it wrong of me to feel at ease in his chest? I don't know. I don't think it is.